In 2015, Megan Abel discovered a series of photographs at a thrift store in Virginia. The negatives were of two unknown women, located on a beach at sunset. The images were instantly intriguing and emanated a beautiful, almost haunting atmosphere, yet they raised many questions. Little did Megan know at the time that this discovery would bring together a community of people from around the globe to try and uncover the mystery behind the girls on the negatives. Examining the photographs closely reveals some important details that were paramount in determining the location they were taken. For one, the coastline visible in the background is fairly distinct in shape, making it possible to compare with coastal regions today. Secondly, a jetty can be seen off in the distance in a number of the stills. Looking even more closely, it's possible to make out what appears to be a crane, indicating that it was still under construction. Using this information, it wasn't long before a location was proposed. It's believed that the photos were taken just north of Gillis Beach Jetty at Playa del Rey, a beach community in Los Angeles, just west of LA International Airport. The coastline can be matched up almost exactly with that seen in many of the photographs, with the distinctive jetty also visible in the background of some of the shots, although it's significantly shorter than it is today. With a location established, the next task would be to identify the date the photos were taken. Starting with the jetty in the background, it's possible to determine a loose time frame for the photographs. Background research revealed that the Marina del Rey jetties were constructed in 1958. A number of photographs taken by the LA County Fire Department show the jetties under construction. The crane seen in the background of a few of the photos is also clearly documented here. This would almost certainly date the photographs to sometime in 1958, before the jetties had been fully completed. The way the women are styled also suggests a late 50s time period. One of the women is wearing a style of dress popular at the time, and both have hairstyles characteristic of the period. Analysis of the negatives themselves also backs up this theory. Shortly after the discovery of the original photographs, local reporter Mark Holmberg was able to track down a second set of transparencies from the same shoot. These images appear to have been taken after the initial set, as the images are darker and the sun is lower in the sky. Interestingly, these images have numbers marked along the edges, 431, 6082. The numbers are speculated to have been something to do with the emulsion batch. With further analysis of these slides and the original set, it's been proposed that the film used was Rexo 431 series 6082. It's hoped that this information may help identify the photographer. Further examining the conditions of the environment helps narrow down the date range considerably. The position of the setting sun in the sky indicates that the photos were taken either in autumn or springtime. A geometrical analysis of one of the photographs determined that it had a horizontal field of view of 37 degrees. For a medium format camera, it has been proposed that a 90mm lens would have a field of view within the correct range. Using this information, it's possible to determine a potential sunset azimuth of 259 degrees. If this is taken at face value, and we assume the photographs have been shot in the fall, the dates that best fit this information are October 17th and October 18th. However, a more conservative estimate would put the date between October 15th and October 20th. This said, the author of the analysis themselves concludes that there are a number of uncertainties present, largely due to assumptions that had to be made in order to complete it, casting some doubt on the accuracy of this evidence. The moon is also clearly visible in one of the photographs, appearing to be a first quarter moon. If the photos were taken in October 1958, the first quarter moon was on October 18th. This date would also line up with the construction of the jetty, which would not have been completed until later that year in November. From the photos, it's easy to discern that the tide was low. Historical data indicates that the only days in October 1958 when the tide was at its low point during or just after sunset are October 3rd, 4th, 16th, 17th, and 31st. October was also an unusually warm month in Los Angeles. According to records from the time, it was the warmest October since they began keeping track in 1944. The hottest temperature of the month was recorded on October 16th, where it peaked at 103 degrees Fahrenheit. The adjacent days were also very hot, with high temperatures of 93 and 100. By the 19th, the temperature had cooled significantly, with a high of 80. These high temperatures would account for the summer dresses worn by both women, and the apparent inclination to wade into the ocean. The Santa Monica Mountain seen in the background of one of the photos would have been over 10 miles away from the beach location, yet are still visible. This indicates that the photos were taken on a clear day. Information regarding the visibility of the area in October 1958 was recorded, with the clearest days closest to the first quarter moon being October 16th and October 17th. Taking all the previous information into account, it seems likely that the photographs were taken just north of Fearless Beach Jetty on Friday, October 17th, 1958, with the adjacent days of Thursday and Saturday only slightly less probable. The purpose of the photographs remains a mystery, but little to go on, theories have been built largely on conjecture. It seems unlikely that the photographs were taken for any editorial purpose, fashion or otherwise. The women are turned away from the camera, and the focus appears to be as much on the scenery as it does on the clothing. That said, this is still a possibility. The general sense given by the photographs is that they were taken for some sort of artistic purpose, either by a hobbyist or a professional. It's been suggested that it could be an impromptu session, quickly organized to take advantage of the favorable weather and beautiful sunsets. It's also been suggested that the photographer could be the women themselves, each taking turns to take photographs of the other. Unfortunately, as of yet, there is little hard evidence. Until further information is unearthed, discussion in this area remains speculative. As for the chain of ownership of the photographs, there's not much to go on. When Megan Abel bought the negatives, she asked the owner of the shop if she remembered who donated them. Luckily, they did, and Megan was able to get in contact with the previous owners. On the topic, she was quoted as saying, "As for the ownership of the transparencies, I was in contact with the ladies who bought them before me, and basically they ended up getting them at this thing called the Shenandoah Yard Crew last year, which is a 42-mile stretch route along a highway in the Blue Ridge Mountains that happens once a year, where people will set up yard sale booths and whatnot to try and clean out some old goods from the past year. They couldn't remember exactly which stop along the way they picked them up, and of course they had paid in cash. There were thousands of booths that were participating. They gave me an approximate chunk of where they stopped, and I ended up grabbing a friend and going this year, asking everyone who might have seen or sold the images. But we didn't have any luck. Over the past few years, a number of theories surrounding the woman's identities have been put forward. Here are a few of the notable ones. Emmett Gowan's wife, Edith Morris. It's been suggested that the photos are stylistically similar to some of the work published by photographer Emmett Gowan. Proponents of this idea have pointed out that the woman in the blue dress pictured in a number of the negatives bears a resemblance to his wife, Edith Morris. As of yet, there is no further evidence to support this hypothesis. The second, and slightly more likely theory, is that the women pictured were Playa Del Rey residents Lou Mills and Evelyn Benson. Both residents of Playa Del Rey in the 1950s, they were neighbors and friends. Their houses situated above the Gillis Beach jetty, near where the photos were taken. Evelyn's husband was a keen amateur photographer, and so it seems possible that he might have been the one who took the photos. It's been noted that both Evelyn and Lou had similar facial features and hairstyles to the women pictured in the photographs. This theory takes into account a lot of what we know about the negatives so far. It explains the relationship between the women themselves and that of the photographer, and it accounts for the specific location, with all of them having been present in Playa del Rey in 1958. The author of the document I've used as a base for this video is Michael Mills, the son of Lou Mills. He explains that he might have vague memories of the photoshoot day, remembering his mother and her friend preparing for a photoshoot down by the sea. Upon first seeing the photographs, his immediate reaction was that they were of his mother. He also recognized the location, having spent much of his youth there. It seems possible then that Lou and Evelyn were in fact the women in the negatives. However, Michael himself points out a number of problems with his theory. For one, in 1958, Lou Mills would have been aged 38 years old, whilst the woman in the blue dress in the photographs appears to be in her 20s. She also doesn't seem to be wearing a wedding ring. By 1958, Lou was married and always wore her ring. Both of these issues lower the probability that they were the women in the photos considerably. Michael also points out that his memories of the photoshoot day are vague at best, and that childhood memories are often prone to being inaccurate, with several previous people also having claimed that the photos may have been of family members, while later being ruled out. He's also been unable to find any copies of the photographs in Lou's personal collection, despite having full access to it. Originally, that's where this story would have ended. In the past 5 years, surprisingly few theories that people have come up with seem to hold much, if any, weight. However, while in the process of creating this video, new information has come to light, and with it, it now seems possible to fully determine the purpose of the photographs and even identify one of the models. Information unearthed by Ray Pellepetz reveals that the photographs appear to be outtakes from a cover shoot for the 1959 Claudia Thompson album Goodbye to Love. The model pictured is almost certainly the woman in the blue dress, with the scenery and background matching perfectly to that seen in the negatives. The agency responsible for the cover was Garrett Howard, who were based in Hollywood at the time. Even more amazingly, it seems likely that the woman in the red dress was Claudia Thompson herself. As of this video's release, it's still unclear as to the identity of the second model, or as to how these photographs ended up in a thrift store on the other side of the country. But for now, at least, it seems safe to conclude that the mystery behind the girls on the negatives has been solved. Before we finish this up, I'd like to thank Michael Mills for curating the document that I've used as a base for this video, as well as Megan Abel and Mark Kongberg for discovering the photos. A link to the relevant document can be found in the description. It goes into much more detail on the subject than what I've covered here in this video. If you enjoyed, a like would be much appreciated. It really helps the channel out.